Good morning, friends, and welcome to my Sunday school class. The title of our class today is The Mercy of Justice, okay? And I'm going to sing a song for you that I pre-recorded called Mercy. So just listen, okay?
I will kneel in the dust at the foot of the cross where mercy paid for me. Where the wrath I deserved, it is gone, it has passed, your blood has hidden me. Mercy. Mercy as endless as the sea. I'll sing your hallelujah for all eternity. We will lift up the cup and the bread we will break, remembering your love. We were fallen from grace, but you took on our shame and nailed it to a cross. Mercy, mercy, as endless as the sea. I'll sing your hallelujah for all eternity.
Hallelujah. Okay. The title of our class is The Mercy of Justice. And welcome again to my Sunday school class. And we're going to look at the key verse, and then we'll go to the Lord in prayer, okay? So here's the key verse is coming from 2 Samuel chapter 9, verse 1. And I'm reading from the NIV version, the New International Version. David asked, "Is there anyone left, still left, of the house of Saul, to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Amen? That's our key verse, okay? And let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you and we praise you, for this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continuously be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Thank you, Father, for food on our table, clothes on our back, shoes on our feet, a roof over our head. Thank you that you're a doctor in the sick room, a lord in the courtroom. Thank you that we are the apple of your eye. Thank you, Father, that you have told us not to be anxious about anything, but by prayers with supplications and with thanksgiving to make our requests known unto God. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding guard our hearts and our minds by Christ Jesus. So we come to you, Lord, casting all our cares upon you, for you care so much for us. And Father, I come to you now for my Sunday school class, Lord. I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable unto you, O Lord, my Savior and my Redeemer. And Father, I pray for a special anointing of your Holy Spirit, to speak forth your word, for we ask it in Jesus' matchless name. Amen and amen. Okay, all right. So let's go to the introduction of our lesson. Mercy That Suits is a song composed by Dr. Margaret Pleasant Dureau that personalizes God's mercy. Through this piece, she explains that God's mercy is sovereignly bestowed and suits the individual situations of those who receive it. God's mercy, she writes, is personalized, individualized, and specialized according to our need for it. Amen and amen. Did you hear that? God's mercy is personalized, individualized, and specialized according to our need for it. When we consider our diverse thoughts, motives, and attitudes and actions, her analysis is understandable. We do not deserve God's mercy, but He grants it because of His faithfulness to His character and His steadfast love. Amen? We do not deserve God's mercy. Did you hear that? We deserve the wrath of God because the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But He grants it because of His faithfulness to His character. What is character? Who God is. Amen? His essence, His character, and His steadfast love. Amen? His never-failing love. His steadfast love. In and of ourselves, we would seldom show mercy to anyone who deliberately hurt or wronged us. We grieve and rebel against God in many ways, yet He still gives us mercy. Amen? Huh? You know, the Bible says, love your enemies, do good to them that hate you and despitefully use you. And when I first read that, I thought, Lord, I'm having hard enough time loving the people I do love, and now you're telling me to love my enemies? That almost seems like it's impossible. And yes, in the natural, it is impossible. But all things are possible with God. Amen? Through the supernatural, through the presence of the Holy Spirit within us, we can love even our enemies. Aha! Okay? Because of God's perfect moral character and limitless wisdom, He sometimes chooses mercy over justice or vice versa according to what His sovereign wisdom deems best. How can one become spiritually mature enough to emulate God's mercy when justice demands otherwise? The key is having faith in God and consistently growing in the knowledge of Him. An excellent example of mercy when justice called for retribution is David's promise to do good for the descendants of his greatest enemy, Saul. Remember, Saul tried to destroy David, He was so jealous of David, and he wanted to destroy him. Justice called for retribution in David's, when justice called for retribution, is David's promise to do good for the descendants of his greatest enemy, Saul. Amen? All right. Let's look at the biblical context of our lesson today. 2 Samuel records the history of David's reign. After Saul's death, David was anointed as king over Judah and eventually king over all of Israel. Chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. As a man after God's own heart, David forged the fractured kingdom into a strong, united one. With God's help, David completed the conquest of the region God promised to Abraham, Genesis 15 and 18. Even God orchestrated success, did not shield him from human failures, nor did they make him immune to the needs of others. The consequences of David's personal sins wreaked havoc in his household and for the nation as well. Yet, David pleased God by showing mercy and justice to those who rebelled against him, his enemies, and the family of Saul. Neither the passage of time nor all he had suffered at the hand of Saul could prevent David from remembering the covenant between Jonathan and himself. 1 Samuel 20. Remember, Jonathan was Saul's son, and Jonathan and David were the best of friends. Amen. With his kingdom secured and his enemies defeated, David was ready to fulfill his obligation to show kindness and mercy to any of his friend Jonathan's surviving descendants. Aha! Okay. All right. So let's now go to the analysis of the biblical text. Point number one, seeking to act justly. It's coming from 2 Samuel chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. Okay. So let's switch to our scriptures. 2 Samuel chapter 9, 1 through 7. Okay. And the story is about David and Mephibosheth. And Mephibosheth was Saul's grandson. Amen. All right, so begins with verse 1. David asked, "Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" And Mephibosheth was Saul's grandson, and he was Jonathan's son, okay? Now, there was a servant of Saul's household named Ziba. They summoned him to appear before David, and the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" "At your service," he replied. The king asked, "Is there no one still alive from the house of Saul to whom I can show God's kindness?" Ziba answered the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan. He is lame in both feet." "Where is he?" the king asked. Ziba answered, "He's at the house of Machir, son of Amiel, in Lodebar." So King David had him brought from Lodibar, from the house of Machir, son of Ammiel. When Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, came to David, he bowed down to pay him honor. David said, "Mephibosheth, at your service," he replied. "Don't be afraid," David said to him, "for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan. I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table." Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Okay, so here is the story of David and Mephibosheth. And who was Mephibosheth? Mephibosheth was Jonathan's son. And Jonathan and David were the best of friends, although Jonathan's father, Saul, was out to kill David. You remember the story how Saul threw a javelin at David to try and kill him and pin him. And David escaped that. Amen? So, now, there was a servant of Saul's household named Ziba. Okay? They summoned him. So, there was a servant, as the story goes, of Saul's household named Ziba. And Ziba was taking care of all of Saul's family that was left over. And they summoned him, okay? Because they figured, David figured, if anybody knows anything about anyone related to Saul, it ought to be Ziba, the servant of Saul's household, okay? To appear before David, and the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" "At your service," he replied. Aha! So Ziba was probably a little suspicious as to why he was being summoned by David, but he was very submissive to David and said, when he was asked, "Are you Ziba?" he said, "Yes, sir." The king asked, "Is there no one still alive from the house of Saul to whom I can show God's kindness?" And so he asked Ziba this question, "Is there nobody alive from Saul's family to whom I can show God's kindness?" Now, this was a sort of a loaded question because according to the culture of that time, when a new king was put on the throne, the new king made sure that all the people that were related to the old king were put to the sword and put to death to eliminate any kind of competition to him. So Ziba was a little bit wary, okay? Ziba answered the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan. He is lame in both feet." He said, "Yes, there is Jonathan's son who is still alive, but he is crippled in both his feet." Amen. And the story goes that when they were running away, the nurse who was nursing Jonathan's son dropped Mephibosheth, and because of that, he was paralyzed in both his feet for the rest of his life. Aha! See what tragic circumstances Mephibosheth had to face. "Where is he?" the king asked. Ziba answered, "He's at the house of Machir, son of Amiel, and Lodibar." Aha! So when David asked Ziba, "Where is he?" Ziba answered, "He's at the house of Machir, son of Amiel, in Lodibar." Now the word Lodibar means a place that's out in the boonies. Okay, it's a godforsaken place, way out somewhere in the middle of nowhere. Okay, that's what Lodibar means. And so Ziba tells him that's where he is. David, he's with Machir, son of Amiel, and he's in Lodibar. So there was no hope in sight for Mephibosheth, because there was nothing of significance in Lodibar. It was a God-forsaken place. And can you imagine how Mephibosheth must have felt out in the middle of nowhere, left with two crippled feet where he couldn't even help himself. And here he is all by himself in the midst of desolation. Aha. And this is a good example of how sometimes we are at times. We feel like we're in Lodibar. We're in a God-forsaken place. Amen. And there seems to be no hope. But with God, there is always hope. Amen? Because guess what? We did not go looking for God, but God came looking for us. Amen. Hallelujah. Huh? The Holy Ghost of heaven, he's the hound of heaven, came looking for me when I thought there was nothing but devastation. There was nothing but hopelessness. Amen? Ah. So King David had him brought from Lodibar. Ah. So from the house of Machir, son of Amiel. When Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, came to David, he bowed down to pay him honor. David said, "Mephibosheth, at your service," he replied. I bet you Mephibosheth was troubled, and he was probably shaking with fear, because as I told you before, the custom of that time was the new king would kill anyone that's left over from the previous ruler. And so Mephibosheth, I bet you, was wondering, here I am lame, and now is David going to put me to death by the sword? Is he going to run me through with the sword? So while he was very submissive, he was very afraid. And I think David sensed the fear in Mephibosheth. And immediately David said, "Don't be afraid, David." David said to him, "Don't be afraid, Mephibosheth." David said to him, "For I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father, Jonathan." Aha! Remember, Jonathan and David were the best of friends, and they had made a covenant to help one another out. And even when Saul was trying to chase down David and kill him, Jonathan would help David escape and would tell him the inside news from the king, where the king would be going to grab a hold of Saul, of David and kill him. Okay? So he says, David said, "For I will surely show your kindness for the sake of your father, Jonathan." So David was a man of his word. And he said, "Because of my friendship with your father, I want to show kindness to you. And David was a God-fearing person. That was the main reason, actually. He feared God. Amen? And he would not do anything wrong. I will restore you to all the land that belonged to your grandfather, Saul. And you will always eat at my table. Hallelujah! Wow! 1 minute, here is Mephibosheth in Lodebar, in the middle of nowhere, in a God-forsaken place. And the next minute, David says, you're going to eat at my table, and I'm going to make sure that you and your family will be well taken care of. Hallelujah! That's how we were. Amen. But God found us. We were crippled. We were crippled by sin. We had no hope. We had no expectancy of anything being good for us. And that's when God stepped in and said, for the sake of my son, Jesus, who died and shed his blood for your sins on the cross, I will forgive you of all your sins, and you will be called the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah! Oh, that is so powerful. That is so powerful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And that's what God did for us. Amen. That's what God did for us. Oh, we can never forget that. We can never forget that. Amen. 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 Thank you, Lord. Okay. David assured Mephibosheth that he had nothing to fear because of the promise he had made to his father, Jonathan. The practice of victorious kings was to execute deposed rulers and their families to prevent further rebellion. Amen? So that was the general practice of victorious kings. David's inquiry and purpose for locating Saul's surviving descendants were unexpected and unprecedented. And you got to understand that Saul was very vicious, and Saul was really out to kill David. And he tried so hard, but every time, because God was with David, David was able to escape. David's commitment to God's standards for justice and his promise to Jonathan motivated him to seek one of his survivors to bless. Despite David's later moral failure against Bathsheba and her husband Uriah, David's integrity towards honoring his word to Jonathan was apparently strong. David could have justified his right to wage revenge against Saul's descendants, but his desire to please God was more potent. The remedy for overcoming anger, resentment, bitterness, hostility, grudge, and strife is an intimate, obedient relationship with God. Amen and amen. Did y'all hear that? Huh? The remedy for overcoming anger, resentment, bitterness, hostility, grudges, and strife is an intimate, obedient relationship with God. When you're intimately related to God in an obedient relationship, that is how you will act. You will act with justice. You will act with mercy. Now here's a question. What do you think? What are the challenges of our intentionally seeking to show kindness towards those who have wronged us? What are the challenges of our intentionally seeking to show kindness towards those who have wronged us? Well, the flesh wants its revenge, doesn't it? The flesh wants to avenge itself, but the Bible says, vengeance is mine, I will repay. So we leave vengeance in the hand of the Lord. And that's the distinguishing mark of a true Christian. Amen? Amen? We do not retaliate. No wonder Jesus said, love your enemies. Do good to those that hate you and despitefully use you. Hallelujah. And you know, in the natural, it's impossible to do that, because our natural proclivity is for vengeance. It's only when the Holy Spirit takes control of us, we can love the unlovable through the agency of the Holy Spirit that dwells inside of us. Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, God in us. Wow, that's powerful, y'all. That's powerful. Now let's go to point number two. Provision for just treatment, 2 Samuel chapter 9 through 12, okay? And so let's switch over to our scriptures. All right, Mephibosheth bowed down and said, what is your servant that you should notice a dead dog like me? Then the king summoned Ziba, Saul's steward, and said to him, I have given your master's grandson everything that belonged to Saul and his family. Wow. You and your sons and your servants are to farm the land for him and bring in the crops so that your master's grandson may be provided for. And Mephibosheth, grandson of your master, will always eat at my table. He was going to eat at the king's table now. Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, your servant will do whatever my lord the king commands his servant to do. So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's son. Mephibosheth had a young son named Micah. And all the members of Ziba's household were servants of Mephibosheth. Hallelujah. Wow. Isn't that awesome? Okay. So Mephibosheth bowed down and said, what is your servant that you should notice a dead dog like me? Can you imagine how Mephibosheth must have felt after Saul died? And actually, Saul committed suicide, so he knew his father had committed suicide. And then David was anointed as king, and he was out in the middle of nowhere in total insignificance. And he must have felt so low that he says, "What is it about me that you notice a dead dog like me? I'm a nobody from nowhere." And I'm kind of surprised you have any kind of interest with me. Then the king summoned Ziba, Saul's steward, and said to him, "I have given your master's grandson everything that belongs to Saul and his family." So that is what he told Ziba, Saul's overseer, Saul's servant, that he had left behind to take care of his family. "You and your sons and your servants are to farm the land for him and bring in the crops so that your master's grandson may be provided for. And Mephibosheth, grandson of your master, will always eat at my table." Hallelujah! So Mephibosheth always ate at the king's table. Amen? Along with David's family and his own children. Wow! So it was almost as if he was David's child. That's how much David loved Mephibosheth and took care of him. Oh, isn't that incredible? Isn't that incredible? Let's look at this a little bit further, okay? David took Mephibosheth into his family and reigned for continuous provisions for his family through Ziba's obedience to farm his land. His kindness to Mephibosheth was extraordinary, to say the least. Although David acted for Jonathan's sake, the motivation was his commitment to model the kindness that God had shown him. Wow. Did you hear that? Although David, I'm repeating this, acted for Jonathan's sake, the main motivation for his commitment was to model the kindness that God had shown him. Hallelujah! Mercy is at the center of God's care for humankind. Justice demanded eternal separation from God, but God granted clemency instead. Our challenge is to emulate his mercy of justice in our relationship with others, and especially the marginalized and the oppressed. Thank God for mercy that suits our case. God's mercy is tailor-made for our individual situation. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Here's the question. What do you think? What is the challenge involved in our leaving vengeance to God and showing mercy to those who have wronged us? Aha! I think the greatest challenge involved is many times we need to swallow our pride. Somebody wise once said, "Pride is the pill that no one likes to swallow." But God says he resists the proud, but gives grace unto the humble. My friends, I don't know about you, but in the day and the hour that we are living in, if there's anything that we need more than anything else, it is the grace of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Here's a closing thought. God's mercy tempers his requirements for justice. If it were not so, then there would be no hope for access to his grace, his steadfast love and kindness for humankind. David's intentional search for any surviving descendants of Saul's is a picture of his justice tempered by mercy. Wow. It is also a picture of our salvation in Christ. Christ came to seek and save the lost for his Father's sake. Through his sacrificial death, we become a part of God's family, having the guarantee that our needs are met and are heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, sharing his spiritual blessing and inheritance. Romans 8:17 from the Amplified Version. Once we've been adopted into the family of God, we are heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, sharing his spiritual blessing and inheritance. Romans 8:17 from the Amplified Version. Okay, your life. This lesson is a challenge to every believer to intentionally show kindness, even to those who cannot reciprocate or to those whom he or she identifies as undeserving. Allow the truth about the fact that God withholds deserved justice and grants undeserved mercy to motivate you to commit to showing it to others. Hallelujah. Here's a closing prayer. God, our Father, thank you for your steadfast kindness. Help us follow your example and show it to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Mercy, mercy, as endless as the grave. I'll sing your hallelujah for all eternity. I never lose the wonder, oh, the wonder of your mercy. May I sing your hallelujah, hallelujah, amen. May I never lose the wonder, oh, the wonder of your mercy. May I sing your hallelujah, hallelujah, amen. May I never lose the wonder, oh, the wonder of your mercy. May I sing your hallelujah, hallelujah, amen.
Hallelujah, amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance towards you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Shalom. Nothing missing, nothing broken. Blessings of God be upon you. Share this, and if you like this lesson, put a like on it. Thank you for listening.